thank you, everyone. I know what it must be like to be the last session here, so thank you very much for being here. And a couple of surprises I wanted to point out. If you look at the agenda, I am not supposed to be the moderator here. But you're going to be so excited that I am the moderator here. But I wanted to say that I think it's a secret plan of Raj to not let Dasra talk about our work. I've been moderating two panels now. So I'm not going to talk about Dasra. So I hope those of you who are really looking forward to it will figure out what we do elsewhere. But what I'm also excited about, and may not be obvious to you all, is we are the most gender-balanced panel in the entire development dialogue. Yes? So did you notice how we're sitting? Anyway, I'm not going to waste any more time because I want you all to hear these wonderful people. We have a tight 45 minutes. And I wanted us to have a conversation that's a bit more future-looking, that really takes into context a lot of the conversations that we've had over these last 2 days. And really, if you can share your perspective on, you know, what does the future look like? And what do we need to be doing to achieve the impact that we want to have and the scale that's really needed to make change? And if you can also share in this question how you see that aligning with the tagline we've talked quite a lot about, which is execute locally, innovate globally, if it relates or it may not relate to your perspectives. If you could share your opinions, and then we'll open it up for questions from all of you. Why don't we start with you, Dominic?
Thank you very much. My name is Dominic McAllister. I'm the Deputy British High Commissioner here in Bangalore in Kerala, covering the whole of the Keralan state. I work for the British government. I've been working for the British government for 25 years. Governments haven't really been working in kind of project work for very long, but they see kind of project work as very useful in terms of diplomacy. We have the Department for International Development. That does a lot of project work, but my part of government, the Department for Foreign Affairs, does not, but we are now in that area. I tend to kind of work kind of both vertically and horizontally. I am a kind of coordinator. I try to bring people together to deliver projects kind of in this state and more widely in India and more widely globally. I've been kind of working in the science and innovation area, so working in a lot of technology areas to try and get people working together across countries, across institutions, across individuals. So the sort of people that I'm talking about on a horizontal level are companies, government, NGOs, academics. If we can get those people talking together, we have a very good mix of ideas coming into activity. On the vertical level, we're talking about kind of grassroots discussions between individuals. The next level up is departments. Next level up is institutions. Next level up is government to government. And where I see I add value to this equation is being able to move around that two-dimensional grid, both vertically and horizontally, trying to bring those kind of people together. I have been kind of working on kind of projects that deal with science and projects that deal with diplomacy. So I have a great enjoyment in terms of if you can get science and diplomacy together, that's where I kind of benefit the most. An example of this was a project that we were working on in the Middle East, trying to bring the countries of the GCC, Kuwait, UAE, Oman, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, and Qatar together to discuss issues of water. It was the Water and Drought Initiative, which the abbreviation will tell you, kind of like it's got a good acronym in that part of the world, WADI, which is a dry riverbed. So we were looking at kind of how you bring kind of discussions on water and water issues between countries together so that people can actually learn from those kind of discussions and try to implement some of the best practice that is coming kind of elsewhere. We were trying to kind of talk both to policymakers, to academics, to companies that were bringing in technology, and to government, because all of them were involved, all of them had a role to play. We were trying also to kind of bring ideas together, because the technology side of water is important, but the social side of water is important. And if these people can talk together, that is an interesting area for them to kind of connect to. That's where I bring value. Kind of, it doesn't always work. Another project that I was trying to work on was an avian flu partnership between the countries of Northeast Asia. So the principal players in this were Taiwan, South Korea, China, and North Korea. And if you've tried to kind of bring South Korea and North Korea together to discuss issues, it is a real problem. But if you are discussing the right sort of issues, you can actually bring these two countries together. Unfortunately, despite the challenges, we've got everybody else to the table, but the North Koreans wouldn't come and discuss how birds will fly south across the South Korean border, delivering avian flu to the rest of the population. But we try. We take risks. Some of these risks work, some of these risks don't. That's my contribution. Thank you.
I'm Karen Heald. I'm with Fidelity Charitable. We are a donor-advised fund in the United States. What that means is I work with donors who have accounts with Fidelity Charitable that are for their charitable funds. Fidelity Charitable was founded about 25 years ago by Ned Johnson, who is the chairman of Fidelity Investments. Since our inception, we have made grants of over $22 billion to nonprofit organizations, both in the United States and abroad. In terms of my role, I am working directly with donors and their families, helping them think through ways they can achieve impact through their grant making. So things like talking through their personal missions, what their goals may be, and devising strategies to help achieve those goals. I've had the pleasure for the last 8 years of working with two of the most brilliant and generous philanthropists of our time, Jayshree and Desh. And through that partnership, I've learned a lot about what it will take going forward as we think about continuing with innovation and scale. I think a few of the key principles that they embody are things that everyone should be thinking about moving, at, whether you're a social entrepreneur or with an organization doing work on the ground. The first is creating models that can be self-sustaining at some point in the future. I think that that's going to be critical as we think about solving some of the world's larger problems. Also, if you are starting a nonprofit organization or a social enterprise, it's really critical to find donors or investors who really understand you. I think that that is really the way to achieve impact. That way the donor and investor is achieving their personal impact, and also you're able to achieve your programmatic impact. So not losing sight of that and what it is that you're setting out to do. And then lastly, I think no matter what type of work you're doing, whether it's at a very high level, trying to change minds, and it's at the policy level, not to lose track of the grassroots community efforts. I think the foundation does such an amazing job of working with the community to identify problems with them and identify solutions as well.
Thank you. I work for Ashoka, and I'm not going to talk about Ashoka, but the question was, what's coming up? What's the future? What's the impact? And what's the scale? So I'm going to talk more about what Ashoka has learned in the last 35 years and the way we have crystallized it, so just to probably give you all a little bit of frame. I'm just going to take on what she just started talking about, the levels on work you all of us will end up doing. So when somebody goes into a village or somebody sees a problem, you go and do something about it. That's the first level of impact, which is very, very critical. That's the core of everything what we do. And we call it direct service or direct impact. You go and do something, you do a direct service to fix it, very critical. The second level is you become very good at it. What do you do with it? You actually start replicating it, right? Meaning you start saying that, I've done it once, now I can do multiple times. And companies are really good at this. If you look at a bank, you open one branch, you become very good at it, you document the processes, and then you replicate yourself. Now, the third level is very critical to look at, which is called, we call it a systemic change. How do you change a system, right? Meaning you've done replication good enough, but how do you change it or impact a particular system? Now, here is where I think the key learning what we have had, and I would like to share it with all of you. So how do you cast a system? I just want to go back to Professor Yunus's model. I see his work in a slightly different angle. So, you know, he scaled all across Bangladesh, right? Meaning he opened his branches all across Bangladesh. How much time would it have taken for Professor Yunus to start a branch in Kolkata? It's very easy, right? Next door, India, you can set up a Grameen Bank branch in Kolkata. He didn't do it. Why he didn't do it? Because he started inspiring everyone to take up his work. Now, everywhere you go, we have thousands of Grameen banks all across the world. X, Y, Z, Grameen, nothing to do with Grameen banks. Now, that's the core of how you cause systemic change. A systemic change literally happens when you let go of something, right? So the question I ask all of you here is that, what are you willing to let go? And when will you let go, right? Because letting go is the core of how you move from a replicated model to something which everybody else will do it. Now, it's again linked to this concept where you say that my organization is no longer important, right? Grameen did not become the key. Or, you know, people did not talk about Grameen as the whole fundamental thing, but people started talking about microcredit or microfinance. So how you shift your focus from your organization to your idea? I think that's the core of what we have seen. And why is it so critical for the future? Is because the future is all going to be about ideas which are going to become larger than the organization. So what is your idea, or what is independently each of your ideas which would become that? And why is it possible? That's the third level which I talked about, was systemic change. The last level of change as we see it is called framework change. Framework change is when you're able to change mindsets, right? So the very simple example is, you know, when Mahatma Gandhi came back to India in 1920s, he said, well, let's all get freedom. And people are like, why? We're actually happy with the British. No, we don't need freedom. But end of it, what happened was, we all got freedom. That's one story of it. But today, what has happened is, if somebody does not have freedom, anywhere in India, even a remote part of India, somebody cannot exercise their freedom, all of us stand up and say, this is rubbish. How can somebody not have freedom? So from having freedom as an external concept to internalizing it as our way of life has taken just 70 years, right? Now that is the framework change. Now, as you see times changing, technology is helping us, each one of us here can cause such framework change. And we are one of the most fortunate generations. Why? Because you just look back. In whatever life you have lived in this planet, you have seen multiple times framework shift. We have adapted to new reality every time and then, right? So that gives the power that each one of us can cause a framework change. For that core, in my opinion, is what can you let go? Thank you.
Thank you. The future is my favorite subject to talk about. At XPRIZE, we're a very futuristic organization, and we spend our time thinking about the future of energy, the future of food, the future of water on our planet, the future of healthcare, education, etc. And I want to build a bit on what Vishnu said. We call that kind of thinking exponential thinking. And we need exponential thinkers, exponential ideas, exponential innovators, because the problem of scale is extremely real. We're all dealing with it all the time. And frankly, it's the beast that we have not been able to tame in the development world. There is no magic formula for reaching scale. So we have to know how we can adapt the technologies, the methodologies of today, and take them exponential very quickly, because we don't have the time to just simply hire more staff, open yet another clinic, open yet another center, open yet another school, and we certainly in the development sector do not have the funding. So then what is the path to exponential change, exponential impact? Well, there's a few things that you all can do. And this is where I see that the future is, and frankly, we see it happening all around us now. I want to leave you with two thoughts and ideas. One is, you must use the power of the crowd. Do not be intimidated. And by using the power of the crowd, I don't just mean crowdfunding. That isn't it. If you now go on the internet, there are many, many sites, guru.com, freelancer.com, elance.com. You need some market research done. You need an impact framework built. You don't have the staff. You don't have a lot of money. Now you need another logo for a new program. Go to namethis.com. You need a small little a film clip. There's indie.com. There's tongle.com. A lot of these sites may not yet be very used in India, But trust me, these are global sites. And when you start marrying the power of the crowd with the power of the cloud and connecting to this global set of people and talent and minds who are out there ready to be used, ready to be helped, you can change how you do business, and you can do it very, very cost effectively. Because for all of us nonprofits, XPRIZE is also a nonprofit, administrative costs and overhead are very real things. And of course, we all know nobody wants to pay for those. We've got to keep them really low. And the second thing that I hope all my past colleagues in the development sector would really, really take to heart is you have to understand, train yourself, and use exponential technologies. What do I mean by exponential technologies? These are technologies, and I'm going to start rattling them off, and everyone's eyes are going to roll. You must use artificial intelligence. You must use robotics. You must understand what advanced sensing can do for healthcare. You must understand how the Internet of Things will change the way you do its services out in villages. You must understand what the blockchain will do for financial literacy and to revolutionize the financial sector for the poor. And there's no time to go into all of these, but I can give you very tangible ways that you can use this in your organization today to help you reach that kind of exponential scale. I know it sounds strange, I know it sounds intimidating. Contact me and I will talk you through it. Thank you.
Thank you, Zenia. I think, thanks for giving me the cue. I was wondering how do I include technology in this whole discussion, and thanks for bringing up that. So just a little introduction of myself. I look out on startup initiative of IBM India. We work a lot with startups. We have around 18 startups working with us. Using our platform. So what we do is that we provide them a bountiful award of cloud credits we have infrastructure service and platform as service. And then we also work on the go-to-marketing side, and we also work on mentoring technology as well as the business. And quickly, I'll tell you a little bit of our key initiatives called the Smart Camp, which is the biggest B2B startup talent that we conduct across the nation, where we identify the top B2B startup talent and get them to connect with VCs, CIOs, get a lot of press coverage, get a lot of social media coverage, and actually you can do a search on IBM Smart Camp and get a whole lot of articles on that. So that's basically what we do. And now coming to the particular topic of what are the future, so I like to tell, I mean, being a technology company, and I'm myself being a technologist for 12 years, I worked as a software architect designing solutions for clients. So I'll probably touch upon two, three areas, and I think Zenia mentioned artificial intelligence, that's one of the key areas, I think, which I definitely see as the future, and IBM also sees that as the future. First is artificial intelligence, second is Internet of Things, and third is mobility around that. So a little touch upon what is cognitive computing or artificial intelligence. So I'll probably take the context of IBM, and you can actually generalize it. So there is this, IBM had this supercomputer in 1999 called the Deep Blue, which was a supercomputer which beat Gary Kasparov on his own game of chess. And after that, IBM invested $2 billion and came out with the next generation of supercomputer called the Watson. So when they tested out Watson, basically Watson is a supercomputer which is in the area of artificial intelligence or cognitive computing. When they tested out it, so there's a show in the US called The Jeopardy where you actually give out hints and you have to guess the question. And Watson was pitted against the previous two winners of Jeopardy, and guess what, it beat the previous two winners in their own game. And after that, IBM started using it for different use cases. And so how this whole, conceptually, broadly how it works is that any artificial intelligence system has three broad areas. One is it understands the natural language processing. It basically understands what we're talking in the human language. And secondly, it processes that and it creates hypothesis in terms of what is the best answer for that. And how it creates the hypothesis is that it's got its own set of database repositories. It could be documents, it could be databases, and it kind of churns that data and comes out with the best answer to that particular question, and it gives rankings to each of these answers, and the one which has got the highest ranking comes with that answer. If the answer is wrong, and it comes up, it's in a self-learning mode, it applies different set of algorithms and comes out with a different answer when the same question is asked. So that's how basically three works. NLP, natural language processing, generates hypothesis based on this database repository. It needs to be trained though. And third is basically it's a self-learning process. Now, basically, I'll give some use cases in terms of how this can be used in the impactful area. So one is healthcare. So let's say you give out the symptoms to the artificial intelligence technologies, and what it does is that it takes out the symptoms and then generates the cause of the disease, and after that it actually tells that what are the things that can be given to for treatment. And actually IBM is working in quite a few hospitals in this particular area. And the same can be applied to the healthcare in India as well. The second is basically you have a Q&A kind of thing. Let's say if a farmer is having certain set of questions, he can ask the artificial intelligence and it come up with the answers to those set of questions. And third would be the image recognition. For example, what it does is that you can have put up in an image and then you can actually correlate that, you know, what is the, like, for example, I take an image of my crop and send it to the artificial intelligence and it will tell exactly that what stage of the crop it is and what are the things that can be done to improve if it is not going as per the plan. Fourth would be another use case which involves IoT, the Internet of Things. So Internet of Things is basically bringing up different sensors and then analyzing the data coming out of the sensors and then taking corrective actions. So I'll give an example of where if you have water canals and water dams, you have sensors in that, you know what water level it is, and then based on that, and you also take inputs from the weather in the cloud, in terms of what the forecast of rain or what's going to be the temperature in the coming 2-3 days. And based on that, you do the analysis and then come up with what corrective actions the authorities can take, what corrective action the farmers can take. So I'll probably conclude here, and there are a lot of things and use cases and technologies that can be further discussed. So I'll hand it over to Neera.
Great. Thank you, all of you. I know how difficult it is to wrap up and give a perspective in those minutes, and I want to be able to open it up to all of you. But just as you're thinking of your questions, just to summarize some of the sort of key pieces that were here, and hopefully you can build on that. We talked about sort of the importance of science and diplomacy, and Dominic really talked about how you need to engage different stakeholders. And interestingly enough, I'm not sure how many of us think about really adding in the piece of diplomacy. Also, what Karen brought up, which we've talked in other panels, really keeping community at the core, despite how at these different levels you might be working, but ultimately that's where we want to see the impact. And then we sort of moved into Vishnu with framework thinking, but keeping in mind where you are funding and the change you're looking to have. But within that framework thinking, what are the triggers that will allow us to sort of have systemic change, to then exponential thinking, really pushing out how technology and all this other artificial intelligence, how do we really sort of leapfrog the sort of linear thinking and change we're looking at all the way to sort of technology as an enabler. And so I've given you all a few minutes to think about your questions. So let's start. Well, what do each of you might say a couple of words on how you see that as a role and whether universities play a role also?
I think kind of some of the areas that we've been working on is to try and kind of improve skills within students so that they can participate in discussions. We have an English language program with the Deshpande Foundation to try and do that. But I very much see kind of the students and youth as part of the discussion process. They are the next generation. They should be contributing their ideas when we're having kind of forum discussions. Sometimes you look at kind of areas of the work that we try to do and we say, let's bring experts together. Experts are fine, but you also need the future experts to be in the room, kind of sharing some of their ideas and some of the kind of things that they are thinking about bringing to that problem when you're kind of trying to frame how you want to move forward.
Yeah, anybody else? Do you also want to add in, I think he also added in the role of universities, and I think there's been a lot of discussion around why do philanthropists fund universities? It's old school giving, it's not very strategic, but clearly there's a role for that to play.
Yeah, so I think one of the work which Ashoka has always done is looking at what makes somebody care for society, right? Meaning, what makes somebody a change maker? Because we have worked with many fellows around the world, we kind of distilled it by saying, what are the qualities in people which will actually make them think about the society? So one of the core elements, what Ashoka has identified, and we put a lot of effort on, is empathy. The skill of empathy. We don't actually, empathy is not just a skill whether you can bond with or not, but empathy is something as a person you can be trained to be more empathetic towards. So one of the things what we have now seen is that from schools and in universities, we work with universities around 40 universities in the US and around the world, is how are universities as spaces offering their students and their young people to become more empathetic. The minute that you offer them the space to become more empathetic, we see that they automatically look at the community around. They automatically look at the problems which are surrounding them, because then they are actually thinking from other shoes. That's literally what happens. So I think universities as spaces where it's no longer about, you know, the specialization of technical specialization, but more about the skills in which they will actually have to embrace to survive better in the future. I think that's where universities have to probably put a lot more emphasis on, in my opinion.
Should we go to the next question? Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon. This is Abhijit from Lakshya Leaders Education Software, Bangalore. For last two and one and a half days, we have been discussing a lot about education, healthcare, and recently you have brought a point on IoT. So IoT, as we see, it's more about automating the things or collecting, gathering more data, so from different sensors, as you said. So or making your life more luxurious when you go and park your car. Parking bay itself will say, hey, don't park me here, you have a better place to park your car. So do you see something leveraging IoT? Can we do something better in terms of education? It's not about, I'm not talking about automating
okay.
the
yeah.
Conference room or something, but do you see something which we can, as the sir also pointed out.
Do you want
out?
To direct your question to any particular?
Yes.
To Radhesh.
Yes.
Yeah, Radhesh and Zenia, do you want to go ahead? Why don't you expand it to also the role of data in achieving impact, I think, as well?
Sure, I'll address exactly his question. So I don't think we're there yet, but I think we're going to get there very soon. So for example, at XPRIZE, we launched a global learning prize about a year and a half ago. This is for a piece of software that'll go on a tablet that will take a child in an absolute zero literacy environment, where the parents are illiterate, where there is no teacher available in the village, from a zero literacy environment to basic reading, writing, and numeracy in two languages, the local language as well as English. Okay? So it's for a piece of software that will go on a tablet. Now, there'll be a lot of gamification to help the child learn themselves with no adult interaction, just peer-to-peer interaction. So once that, we're going to test this in rural Tanzania. We've identified with the World Food Program, we've identified a cluster of villages where we're going to test the final five teams technology. Once that is done, we're hoping that the devices that start coming out that can help in illiteracy situations to make, you know, 1.3 billion children across the world still can't read or write, we're hoping that there will be next evolutions of it. And I can envision next evolutions using IoT where if there are, the sensing technology is getting ridiculously cheap. Very, very affordable. That if there are a couple of sensors are in their environment, when they're walking past that, the tablet or whatever their learning device is, maybe it's a watch, maybe it's a band, you know, will tell them fridge, car, train, whatever it might be. I can see applications like that. Maybe not in, frankly, in the rural homes, let's be honest, but maybe in the village. Maybe in a school setting or in a community setting. So I can very easily see that coming in the next 5 to 8 years, maybe.
Radhesh, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, so a couple of, I think, Gina, rightly you mentioned it. Just want to do a couple of points on top of that. So one is that you can use the Internet of Things, for example, to know what's the attendance that's going on at a particular remote area. And like you have sensors that you can put a camera, and then you have the video analytics which will actually sense the number of people, students present there, and whether the teacher has come or not, just by putting up a camera, or just images which can be taken periodically and sent to the server, and it can do the processing. The other thing is that one of the key issues is about the interaction that happens between the students in the remote area versus the professors who could be sitting anywhere. So how about interacting them with the different devices which Sina mentioned? How about having a live Q&A kind of session if, for example, there is a, through a satellite, if you are delivering the sessions and then you want to have a quick way of asking questions and all that, so that you can probably use a device which actually kind of acts as an IoT sensor for that questions, and then you can actually give the responses back via the devices. So that's a couple of use cases which I can quickly think about.
Great. Thank you. Let's go to the question over here, gentlemen. Yes.
Thank you all for showing us the possibilities. But there is a great nervousness, which is we had digital divide. Slowly we are moving into an age where there will be knowledge divide. There will be few people who may call this IoT, understand Watson's algorithm, and then push it onto really unknown countries, villages in Tanzania, where we can sense what people are doing. But how do we empower them to build these things? Otherwise, slowly this will become a very complicated pyramid where few people are able to innovate very sophisticated things. And a whole world becomes a consumer. Facebook, WhatsApp, all these are examples. Nobody knows what's happening to the data when you use WhatsApp for your communication, right? So are we not heading to a really serious problem area? Should we not address that in a democratic way?
And I'm going to ask, sorry, Zenia, I'm going to ask Dominic and Karen to kind of share your perspectives and just to you know, give you the question a bit, which was, with all of this sophistication and technology, are we only going to be growing this digital divide? And is it really ultimately going to empower and help the communities, Karen, that you were talking about? But as far as will it be a big enough divide that it, you know, defeats the purpose of sort of democracy? Do you want to try?
I see this area as a very interesting area. You're kind of working with governments who are quite kind of, they're not thinking in these sort of big kind of grand ideas. They're thinking in the kind of traditional ways of doing things and then trying to kind of put the technology on the top. But you talk about kind of divides and digital divides. I think there are great opportunities for emerging economies, emerging communities to take on new technologies because they don't have the holdback of the existing technologies that are delivering the services as we do now. You see some amazing kind of changes, for example, in Africa with use of mobile technologies, which we don't use in kind of Europe at the moment because we're still very much using kind of the kind of the technology one step back, and it's difficult to kind of move rapidly to new technologies as we go through. So I see if you can persuade governments that it is in their interest to adopt new ideas, it is possible to kind of keep kind of emerging economies jumping ahead of existing economies in certain technology areas.
I think that it's absolutely critical, the effort to reduce that divide. And I know that it takes time for certain technologies to make their way into rural communities and the cost needs to come down. But I think with brain power that's in this room and the philanthropic dollars that are available to the space, I think we will see it happen. I think it's absolutely a must and it's critical.
Yeah, I'm so sorry I have to jump on this because I've spent my whole career at the nexus of technology for greater good. So please don't be intimidated and don't think this is going to happen. I'm quite confident that it will not. It may happen in certain circumstances, it always does, but look at the mobile revolution. Look at how nervous all of us in development were in the early 2000s. What is this? How is this going to impact us? Why? And then we started using it, then our customers started using it, then they taught us how to use it better, you know, and we said, no, but now smartphones are coming and they're not literate enough to understand it, and absolutely nonsense. You know, they adopted it very, very quickly. So I don't see this as a top-down approach at all. In fact, there are so many hackathons going on, and at the university level, sir, the question you were asking, you know, those are the things that universities can also do, you know, more hackathons for the sort of base of pyramid, grassroots level technologies for high impact. Work with your local colleges, partner with them, as a development agency, whatever areas you're working in, and you will see that the digital divide is only going to grow narrower and not broader. This is the beauty of the world today. This is why we are living and operating in a globalized world, and this is how all of you as development agencies will be successful in that world to reach the one thing we're all here for, and that is big impact. So please don't be intimidated by that.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just have a very quick question for Zahia. Do you find that there's a certain demographic that is creating exponential technology, and secondly, using exponential technology?
Yeah, I mean, it's the younger generation. You know, it's the millennials that are adopting these technologies a lot quicker. They're adapting these technologies a lot quicker as well. And yes, they are developing them quicker too. I mean, just, you know, the last couple of days being here in Hubli and meeting some of the young entrepreneurs and even meeting people at Thai, there's an amazing team here working on virtual reality. That they're looking at not just for games and entertainment, which is where the money is right now in virtual reality, but they're looking at for applications for healthcare, for imaging, for all kinds of different things, for surgeons to be able to go into the operation theater, having much more of a better perspective. So yeah, I do find it's the younger generation that are working on it, but that doesn't mean the rest of us have to be left behind. We can learn how to do this. You just go on the internet. There's a lot of great sites. You can sign up, get their new newsletters and learn. Just disrupt yourselves.
Yeah, Vishnu, you're gonna add?
Yeah, so I think, you know, one should also note that it's exponential X, right? I mean, it can be anything which can be moved to exponential, anything which can change frameworks, right? I think it's absolutely true that the young people are embracing it much quicker because, you know, with the social media and various platforms what we have, we are more connected than before. So to create a social movement now, it's much easier than what it used to be 10 years ago. And obviously, people who know to use technologies are still in the younger age group. But honestly, that's changing, right? Meaning with the smartphones and the various technologies which are commercialized, it's changing. Now, if you're all able to adapt to certain kind of technology or networks which can actually reach a lot large number of people, anybody can actually cause a movement. So that's the trick. What are the things you need to embrace so that you can cause a movement? And young people are doing it much better than others. That's honestly true, yeah.
Great.
Just to add on Vishnu's point, and it's all about, and Zenia's point, it's all about now democratizing open source. So you have APIs where if you can have a complex artificial intelligence functionality just by an API call, and you can get those functionalities. For example, if you want to do a personality insight, I just give my Twitter handle and it'll tell what kind of personality I am. If I have to develop the algorithm myself, it's going to take me some years. But what I can do is that I can just give an invoke API call and I get a response at what kind of personality I am just based on my Twitter handle. So it's all about democratizing in the form of APIs, and you can have, I mean, for example, the concentrations like Deshpande Foundation and all that, that's where you can foster these kind of technologies and propagate that.
Great, I'm gonna take two questions. There's a gentleman in the blue shirt and yourself, and then we're gonna wrap answering all, and all of you can give a perspective to the question and some advice. So if you can keep your question short, that'll be great.
Yeah, so my question is with Jania.
Sorry, start with the gentleman in the blue shirt and then yourself, yeah?
Okay, blue shirt first.
Blue shirt first.
Yep. Blue, and then brown.
And then you.
We get to do the last.
My question is, this is regarding R&D and the incubations. Mostly in India, this concept is only with the IITs only. Why don't these private organizations come forward for this kind of an incubation centers and R&D kind of a and creation of such kind of an atmosphere in India, particularly?
Sir, they're all over.
Okay, hold on one sec, Zenia. It's definitely going to be something you're going to answer. I'm going to take this second question as well.
Brown shirt.
So don't forget.
Brown. Okay.
Yeah, brown shirt. Sorry.
Yeah. My name is George Abraham, just in case people don't call me Brown later.
Sorry. Thank you, George.
Not at all. Okay, I think listening to all of you, we are in for a very, very beautiful world ahead of us. One thing I'm a little scared about, digital India, technology, a beautiful world future. There is something called screen reading software, magnification software, which bridges the gap with people with vision impairment and some of the disabilities. Now, I just like to, it's more of a thought I'd like to leave with all of you, because you guys are leaders as far as technology is concerned. When something is created, taking the world forward, don't leave us out. We want to be part of the technology, we want to be part of the beautiful world that has been created, we meaning visually impaired people, disabled people. So bridge us in so that we can run along. It's a great opportunity to include.
Great, and so with those two questions, and if in your responses you can also leave folks with, you know, the one or two things that people should focus on if you really want to achieve impact in the future. We've talked a lot about technology. There's a lot that needs to go around that to actually make it successful. So yeah, I guess closing thoughts as you respond to some of these questions.
It's great. It's very interesting, kind of the discussions about social divides and kind of who's leading kind of new technology revolutions. My kind of take on that is that there are kind of certain countries that are leading. There are certain elements of the population, of the kind of age groups that are leading kind of technologies. It's important not to leave out the others. I'm one of the oldies. I need to be brought along. I need to be introduced to the new technologies. I could be making decisions on new technologies. If I don't understand those technologies, then it's going to be harder for the rest of the population to kind of move forward, I think. And the question there about kind of including other groups kind of in this revolution, it's very important to incorporate fast movers, medium movers, and slow movers in all your kind of discussions, because they are going to be all involved in this. You can't leave people out by moving too quickly sometimes kind of in the scale of things. I've come at this kind of issue from a kind of government point of view, and a lot of these issues are being discussed at a grassroots level, and then the grassroots will rise up to change how kind of society will exist in the future. I think that is true, but there is a role for kind of governments, there is a role for decision makers, there is a role for community leaders all across this. And the trouble is that they can make it easy for people, or they can make it more difficult for people. On the R&D side, it is making a passage between kind of technologies emerging from universities, from research groups, into the community. How can we make that easier? All of this kind of requires, I think, that people work together from a top down to a bottom up. You need to have all those kind of people involved in that kind of discussion.
Yes, I think broadly, to sort of address both points and questions, I think to echo your comments, it all comes down to two things for me. First, collaboration. I know it's a word we use all the time, but as you're thinking and working, you know, try not to isolate yourself. Try to connect with other people, whether it's online or in person. Take advantage of any network you can possibly think of. And I think it's important also, as we think about people with different abilities, to be inclusive and to try and have your network be very diverse. People with all different backgrounds, I think that's very valuable. And then the second thing is just passion. As all of you continue in your work, I think having some grit and perseverance as you tackle these difficult challenges is critical. And really just your personal drive and that commitment to changing the world is what's going to make it happen.
Yeah, for me, I think I see that the world, the problems are actually trying to outrun solutions, and it's not good. So I think, one, the future is going to belong to every one of us who is just going to own a problem and cause change with it. It doesn't matter how big, how small. With all the platforms, technology, the future, connectedness, collaboration is going to be so easy. So, you know, just making sure that we all can start something, doesn't matter what, but just go ahead and start something, that itself is going to be the way the future is going to operate.
Thanks. So, two questions. R&D, incubation, lots going on right here in India. Right here in Hubballi, I was at Sandbox Startup Incubators. Amazing. Every single person there was working on really great things in the energy space and IoT with sensing technology. And this is not for the IBMs of the world. They're working for Aam Aadmi, for the common man, and how their commercial ventures, small commercial startup ventures, are going to help every one of us, and how they're going to change lives and villages. So this is happening. We can talk more offline. I can connect you to some others that are doing it as well. And what a great point, sir, about not leaving the disabled behind. That is extremely huge. But I have to say, I'm very much of an optimist, and I think this big, bright, glowing future is going to make the lives of people who have impairments a lot easier and a lot better to assimilate into mainstream society. That is the beauty and the power of technology. Obviously, technology on its own does not solve poverty, and it does not solve every problem in the world. Technology has to be wrapped around with the right kinds of services, the right kind of financing, the right kind of adoption and outreach, and to get it way past the last mile into the hands of everybody. And I think that's the challenge we're all working on. But it is happening, so keep faith.
Thank you. Definitely, I completely agree with Zenia in terms of the technology aspect, and I see technology as a key enabler in the area of impact. Four areas which I would probably identify. One is artificial intelligence, second is Internet of Things, third is mobile, fourth is analytics. These are going to be key players. Just watch out for my words in the coming months or coming years. And with regard to participation, these technologies will be open out in the form of APIs. IBM has already opened out quite a bit of this technology in the form of APIs. Just give an API call and things are provisioned for you. Like for example, you can go into search and do a Google on Dumix and you'll find those different set of APIs. So yeah, I personally am very optimistic about the use of technology and how this can be also spread across the different parts of India using the form of APIs.
Great. Well, that brings our panel to a close. Thank you all for your questions, and thank you, my dear panelists, for engaging in a conversation.
Thank you very much. Please accept this small gift.